I hope you had a good lunch break. I personally always loved it when someone totally commits to a talk and shows up in army cargoes to a data demolition talk. So let's welcome our speaker.
All right, I hope we have audio on the computer here. I'm not getting anything out now, but I'm not getting the clicky bits when I change the sound, but have a check. At any rate, we don't really need it, but there's just a little bit of background audio in some of the stuff, some of the videos.
You can't do the volume, or what's the...
Not hearing anything. We'll see what happens when we get to some audio. So I'm going to move pretty quickly through the introductory material here because there's a lot of stuff this talk length. But basically, this is about the security risk of the waste stream. So, you know, we throw a lot of stuff away, and we need to make sure that that stuff that we throw away doesn't contain various secrets. Secrets, if we're a business, from our competitors, from criminals who might want to exploit us, and just from the general public. This is a lot of embarrassing stuff that we don't necessarily want to be public. You know, it would be embarrassing if it was public. Old school method of hacker industrial espionage, right, was going trashing. I'm sure a lot of people in this room are old enough to remember when you'd go like to the phone company or something and go through their trash to find old phone manuals and stuff like that. But we're not dealing with printouts in a dumpster anymore. We're dealing with terabytes of data on relatively small storage units that get thrown away. And so here are some examples. There was some great research presented a couple of years ago where people were buying up old printers and copiers and pulling the hard disks out of them to see what was on them. And all kinds of stuff was on them, from businesses, sensitive documents that had been scanned on a copier and they were still resident on the hard disk, classified documents on old government machines. A well-known problem. And then also an interesting thing that, you know, maybe people haven't thought about so much is that now we have extremely capable mobile machines, like drones, like autonomous vehicles, and the data storage in those machines contains corporate secrets, right? If you take down an experimental autonomous vehicle or a military drone, it's going to have a hard disk in it, and it's going to have stuff on it that maybe someone finding the carcass or destroying that machine shouldn't have. But this talk is not really about any of those specific examples. It's more like, what if someone tries to take this data before you throw it out, while you're still using it? So the scenario I want you to imagine is you're running a data center and a criminal organization comes and breaks into your data center and holds up the stuff at gunpoint and then tries to pull out a bunch of the hard disks. Maybe they've got a lot of valuable information on it and it's worth mounting that kind of a raid. So what I'm looking for is a switch that you can flip and immediately all of the storage is gone. No bits are left standing. And so I'm sure most people are thinking, well, okay, why don't you just encrypt everything? That's certainly good practice, but it's not necessarily a panacea because crypto is only as secure as the key. And keys may be unexpectedly recoverable from access to the physical media in ways that you just might not know about. You may not know what that hard disk firmware is doing with a small piece of information that is the key to everything else on that drive. And so I'm looking for a data center scale solution, something that could scale up to a lot of hard disks. And threat model is always important, right? When you're doing any of this kind of defensive research, what is the capability? So let's just go all the way. Let's assume an extremely high capability adversary that's got a lot of money. They're willing to spend whatever it takes to do forensic recovery of whatever they can pull out of the wreckage. So let's look at what people do industrially. You know, if you are a government organization or a business that gets rid of data in a proper way, decommissioning disks, what you'll do is you'll degauss if it's magnetic media, you'll degauss it first, and then you'll throw it into a machine like this, an industrial shredder. You know, you can see it's making absolutely short work of these hard disks that are getting tossed into it. Once again, you have to predict your adversary. So I've discussed this a lot with people that did forensic recovery work in a military context. So United States Marines who were tasked under certain three-letter agencies in the United States with recovering physical media in Iraq. And they were under instructions that if they found any data storage device, even if it had been physically crushed, broken, bashed with a sledgehammer, destroyed. If it wasn't also burned, they were to recover that and send it in for a forensic analysis. So what we can take from that is if you really want to nuke your data from orbit, then you should degauss, you should crush and shred, and then you should also burn. So that's what informs you know, what I'm going to do in terms of this research, which operates under also a more restrictive set of rules. So here are the rules. The server is one U. So the thing that's containing all the drives, you get a U for the drives, plus anything else you might want to squeeze in there, and then one U above and below for whatever you want. So that could be blast protection, it could be hot gas extraction, it could be you know, mechanisms for delivering whatever the data destruction method is. 60 seconds to completion. So flip the switch. Anyone who's even if they're running in with guns into your data center, they're not going to be able to pull stuff out of your server racks in less than a minute. We don't want to set off our fire suppression systems. That's expensive. You know, causes other problems, and we want to contain the damage within this equipment. So nearby equipment that's not related to the storage shouldn't be damaged. And finally, nearby humans should also not be damaged. Quick look at hard disk technology, because I think it's really interesting. We all have them. We've used them for a long time. The traditional hard disk has these spinning platters. They're made out of aluminum traditionally. More frequently these days, they're made out of glass. That makes them easier to break. So I'm going to concentrate on aluminum platters with the spinning stuff. The way that we achieve these incredible data densities, right, multiple terabytes in a 5.25-inch hard disk package, is really interesting. They have the aluminum is coated with underlayers of cobalt, nickel, iron. There's a cobalt, chromium, platinum magnetic alloy. So there's some like valuable materials in your hard disk. In between these layers, four atoms thick separation layers of ruthenium. Ruthenium very chemically resistant. So that's the main reason why. I did a couple of experiments, but there's basically no chemical attacks that covered in this work. And then, of course, personal storage and some industrial storage moving over to solid state drives for better performance. And these are just flash memory chips soldered to a board. So we have a pretty good understanding physically of what solid-state drives are made up of. So I'm going to look at three different attack methods, different classes: thermal, using heat; kinetic, anything that physically breaks it; and then electrical attacks, which is mostly for the solid-state drive case. So starting off with thermal, our goal here is to thermally demagnetize. Right, just as in why you'd want to burn the fragments of a drive if you physically smashed it, it's basically to get rid of that magnetic information on the drive. So for cobalt, which is your typical magnetic storage element, little over 1,000 degrees Celsius is the Curie point. That's where the spin states de-align, you lose the ability to read that coherent magnetic information. So here are some things that I am not exploring in this presentation. Because either other people have done it, such as this case, heating things up with flames from outside. Short version is 5.25-inch hard disks are great heat sinks. There's a big slug of aluminum at the bottom of them. So if you try to heat them up with a torch, it takes a long time. You can do it, but it doesn't really satisfy the 60-second rule. I really wanted to find some chemical reactions that were flameless, because, hey, that makes it really easy to contain it. But I couldn't find any that get to over 1,000 C. And then using a kiln powered by electricity or gas, or an induction furnace. I didn't look at those because we know they would work. It takes a long time to get a kiln up to temperature, so that doesn't satisfy the 60-second rule. Induction furnaces also, they would have the advantage that they would degauss at the same time as they heat it up. But you know, if you throw a hard disk in an induction furnace, it'll melt. So we know that works. It wasn't interesting to research. So number one, what's lying around the shop that I can try on a hard disk and a thermal attack and just see if it'll work? So the plasma cutter, right? So the plasma cutter is a very compact package. We know we could fit that in a 1U device. So here's what happens. There we go, we've got audio. When you attack a drive with a plasma cutter. As you can see, it's pretty low profile in terms of the amount of mess that it's making, basically none. The drive, by the way, you can see it's powered up. It started off spinning, so my idea was if I hit it at one spot, the platters will spin and maybe we'll destroy everything on the platters. It's just moves along. It's quiet. It takes about 40 seconds before you get the nice little flame coming out the side to let you know that it's done. So here we go. Let's open it up and have a look. By the way, like I said, it's a good heat sink. So a good heat sink stores a lot of heat. So the drive was extremely hot. So this opening scene is after I'd burned myself repeatedly trying to get the screws out of the hard disk. And you can see it's burned a really nice hole in the platters there, and you can see some scarring as it was spinning. But it didn't spin for the whole time, you can see that. Here's a close-up. So we've scarred the surface of the platter. At a certain point, thermal expansion made that spindle seize up and it stopped spinning. But we definitely drilled through all of the platters, made a nice mess of it. So if you wanted to do this, I think it is very feasible. But you would need a bunch of plasma heads, and that's no problem at all. Making a custom device that has a little a ring of plasma heads, because it's not going to keep spinning, and you'll burn through the drive in 6 or 8 places. And I think we can say that probably no one's going to recover much data from that drive. So great, this was day one, and I was like, all right, I already got something to work. So then I thought, well. Aluminum, right? Most of the platters, they got a chemically resistant covering, but most of the platter is aluminum. It's a great fuel. What if I could use the drive itself to combust itself, right? It's its own worst enemy. And to do that, what we would need is a lot of oxidizer. So we would need to devise something that would puncture the drive and inject oxygen into it and just create a little spark to get it going. And hopefully we could consume most of the drive. So I plumbed a little line in here and fed pure oxygen into it and set off a little spark. And here's some footage of this experiment. So we're really not putting anything in there except for oxygen. So a little spark is all it takes. Oxygen makes things burn great, and eventually it melts the hose, and I had to shut it off before I caused a serious fire in the lab. Here's a little shot of that in high speed. This is the Sony FS700, so it's a few hundred frames per second. But you can see a lot more sparks coming out when you watch it in high speed. But definitely not uncontainable, right? You just need a gas extraction system, and you'll be able to keep that under control. So that's what it looked like afterwards. We open it up, and we can see, there's been a fair bit of damage. After we clean it off, we can see that once again, the drive has stopped spinning, but it's consumed part of that platter without any problem. You can really see that it's eaten away down the bottom here. So I think this method is potentially feasible. Like a little bit more engineering effort to get everything going, but I felt pretty comfortable that you could get that to work. But most of my work in the thermal space was because every time you mention to someone you're going to do some hard disk destruction, yeah.
How much oxygen did you need?
Well, I had a little map gas bottle, so I didn't measure it, but not very much. It was one of those tiny little map gas welding torch bottles. So, and we used a negligible amount of the bottle. When you start say to people you're going to do data destruction, physical data destruction, everyone's like, yeah, thermite. So, okay, of course we have to do thermite. And this is something like, it's not just messing around, right? I really wanted to know how well does this work, because everyone says that's the thing to do. So, all right. And we know that the military uses thermite grenades for doing data destruction, right? If you've got a filing cabinet or if you've got a hard disk, you strap a thermite grenade to it and you let it go. So I wanted to do something, something more experimental. And in particular, I wanted to see if I could make an injectable thermite slurry. So something that you could have a hydraulic penetrator that would act like a syringe, inject the drive with this stuff and set it off and see if that would work. So here's the thermite formula. Almost anyone who's taken high school chemistry knows this reaction. You've got an iron oxide and an elemental aluminum. They swap the oxygen over, you get molten iron. You release a lot of thermal energy, and it gets up to about 2500 C. So to make it at home, 3 to 1 by weight. Very easy. And you don't even need particularly fine material. Obviously, the finer, the faster it'll go, but you can use quite cheap machine shop turnings of aluminum stuff and still get it to go. Long story short about the slurry, by the way, I could not get it to work. I tried a lot of different variants. None of them worked. I tried a lot of different solvents to make the slurry, and they all seemed to inhibit the reaction pretty seriously. So too bad about that. I don't have time to show you those experiments, but they didn't work. So I had to switch gears here, and I thought, well, all right, if you're really running running a secure disk that you want to explode, we really care about what's inside it, and we don't want to have to deal with all the heat sink on the outside. And 5 1/4 inch drives have space in them. You can put things in them. You can open them up. And those read heads never have to go there. So also, the data bus has some unused pins on it. So I could put a little igniter on two of the unused pins and still have a working hard disk that once I put my 15 gram baggie of thermite in it, you've got this nice little thing. And smugglers take note, I guess. You can totally put things inside a working 5 1/4 inch hard disk. Interesting aside here, right, in light of current events, when I was doing this research, I was doing some work in Turkey, and I didn't have time to go home and get all my hard disks, so I was carrying this giant sack of hard disks through Istanbul airport, and of course I had to answer a lot of questions from Turkish customs, but they didn't already have the thermite in them, so that's okay. But anyway, so here's the 15 gram thermite pre-insertion. In real time. So, great, it does its job. We open it up, we see thermite residue, we see we've definitely made a mess in there. But once we just take a brush to it and start looking at that platter, it looks like it's resisted pretty well. And sure enough, once it's fully cleaned, you can see there's like basically no scarring at all to those platters, right? That coating, that ruthenium coating is effective. So that's a total fail, no question about that. Now, the military thermite grenades don't actually use regular thermite. They use a variant called Thermate, which has 30% barium nitrate in it. So what the nitrate does is it produces gas, and it spreads everything around, and it actually makes the mixture burn a little bit hotter as well. Barium nitrate's toxic, so it's not the nicest stuff to work with, but the military uses what they need. So I thought, well, I'll give that a shot too. So there's the real time. Same story, right? A little baggie, about 15 grams inside the drive, and here's a high speed shot of that. So that you can see what really happens. So igniter starts, and then it really gets going. You can see that gas production element is like really doing its job. It's like really looking like a firework now. More sparks and debris than the plasma cutter, but we could totally deal with this much stuff spitting out of the disk if it works. Right, so that's engineering. This is science. Engineering comes later. So we open it up. Gloves this time, right? I'm learning. And immediately there's like a qualitative difference with what we see here. We can see all of those little pellets of molten iron that have been spread around on the drive. We feel a bit more confident here. This is post-cleaning. So once again, things like don't look as disgusting as they seem once you clean them off. But we can see iron has attached itself to the drive read heads. The drive platters have started to delaminate, and they've actually been welded together over the side there by the molten metal that we've created. So it's done a better job. But looking at the rest of that platter, we have to also conclude that this is a fail. Sadly enough, but I'm not ready to give up yet. There are other types of thermite that we can make. In particular, copper thermite is a very interesting one. It's exactly the same kind of thing, right? You've got copper oxide and aluminum, 4.4:1 by weight for those following at home. This is a very aggressive thermite. So here's a little unconfined pile of it that I'm lighting up with a torch. So we've almost got a flash powder here, right? That's very, very different from the kind of slow burn that we saw from the iron thermite. So here is a same thing. We've got a little baggie in the behind the read head space in the drive, about 15 grams roughly. Let's see this shot in high speed. Just keep watching. It's a little hard to see, but you'll see the lid of the drive come down there. But keep watching. In another couple of seconds, there's the drive itself. So from a standing start on the concrete, it bounced up and flew, you know, God knows how high in the air. It's also produced a giant toxic cloud. We had to all run outside, and so that's what the top of the lid looked like afterwards. So it makes nice patterns, very artistic.
You can tell on eBay.
Yeah, right. Here's the drive itself. Nicely coated, very very conductive at this point with all that copper. And we can see from the side there that it's got all through the entire drive. Up in, you can see a lot of like copper around here. There's another thing there of where the copper has attached itself. Liquid copper, basically, spraying all around inside this drive. Here we are, opening it up and rinsing it off. Not the recommended way to clean a drive that you still want to use, but... Once again, you know, it scrubs up pretty good. Here it is post-cleaning. So we've produced a lot of copper and attached it to the drive, but that would be very easily removable. You know, you could mill that off carefully. You could chemically remove it. So I don't think we trust this, our well-funded criminal organizations. We don't trust them with the drive that this has happened to. So infeasible but fun for the copper thermite. But I'm still not ready to give up on thermite, all right? Because people say, well, you know, you just put a big thing of thermite on top of the drive and it will just melt through. So I was like, all right, we've got to try it. So I cast myself a mold out of refractory ceramic that fit on top of the drive inside 1U. That's exactly 1U drive plus case. It's matched exactly to the drive, and it's got a nice space in the middle of it that we can pack with a much more significant amount of thermite. We can fit about 250 grams of thermite into that. So. Here you can see just the start of the, this is a high-speed video, and I've clamped everything down with two big clamps, and hopefully we can keep everything from flying all over the workshop. Wow, not entirely successful at containment here, but once again that's. That's engineering. If it works, if we significantly destroy the drive, then we can figure out a way to contain that. I feel confident in that. This was done in a friend of mine's workshop, and he has a large rug on the floor, and this actually set a significant amount of that rug on fire. Sorry about that. Here we are opening it up. So, you know, looks promising so far. There it is right after we opened it up. You can see some big lumps of molten, formerly molten iron, right, that have collected on top of there. And most importantly, we have burned a hole in the top of the drive cover. But once we look underneath, you know, the electronics is melted and things are messy, but it all looks pretty good, right? It turns out those drives are really good heat sinks. So this method, thermite in general, I say is unreliable. So next time you hear someone say, "Oh yeah, thermite your drives," ask them, "Have you really tried it?" All right. So moving on. Yes.
You tried it on glass platters?
No, I in general stayed away from glass platters because they were going to be so easy to break kinetically, right? So stuck aluminum platters for the thermal and then also for the kinetic. You know, I just knew you can shatter a glass platter really easily. Like open up a laptop drive and bend a platter and it will explode everywhere and probably cut you. So the goal for the kinetic work is we want to deform, spindle, mutilate the platters of the drive in such a way that it would severely retard any ability to mechanically scan them and recover the data from them. We know from the beginning of this that this method would have to be used in conjunction with degaussing, but it's easy to degauss. So we're just going to look at like how effectively can we quickly crush a drive. Things I didn't do, most drive crushers that you can buy off the shelf crush a drive from the top, which doesn't fit in my sort of 3U rules. But so I thought about building a hydraulic cutter or crusher that operated from the side, and I decided not to do it because I knew that it could work. And similarly, there's a lot of high pressure cutting tools like water jet cutters and stuff like that you could use. You can definitely cut a disc with them, but the amount of infrastructure you need, you know, 15,000 PSI compressor and so on, it seemed sort of not really in the spirit of things. So I stuck to things that I thought could be justified by my original rules. So first of all, I thought, like, you know, I've used one of these nail guns a bunch, you know, to put nails in concrete. And they're basically a little gun. They have a 22 caliber pyrotechnic propellant charge that fires a nail, goes into concrete. And so here's an example of it going into concrete or a cinder block. And it happens so fast at 480, you can't even see the nail go through. So you know, if you can go through a slab of rock, I feel like, oh, you can definitely go through a hard disk. So I milled the end off a drive so that you could see inside it, you can sort of see. I have to confess, I made a few failed attempts here to fire the nail gun from the top, but the top is too spongy. You have to, this nail gun, you got to hit it with a hammer to make to fire the charge. So I had to flip the drive over and fire it through the bottom. But here you go, doing it. It has no problem whatsoever, even going through the bottom. So it punches straight through and goes through all the platters. So that's great. And at the same time, I borrowed a pneumatic nail gun from someone, and I thought, well, I'll give that a shot. I don't have high hopes for it, but I'll give it a try. So same hard disk, just thought I'd just fire a pneumatic nail through it. And that also has no problem whatsoever going straight through a hard disk. So okay, great, I learned something there. There we go, you can see that it's severely warped all through three platters, it's gone straight through, it's made a hole. So you'd need a ring of them, but that's super easy to fit into 1U. So I think that's a very feasible method to just instantly puncture a lot of drives. So, you know, once again, the simple things off at the start work kind of well. But what I really wanted to do in the kinetic section was to do some stuff with high explosives for a few reasons. One of them is, like, you know, I'm in a position that I can do this kind of research. Not many people are, so I felt like an obligation to do that. But also some other interesting things, which I'll just get to in a sec. But first of all, there's no doubt we can destroy a disk with high explosives, right? This is not even in question. Not only can we break it apart, but we can get thermal factors out of it as well. We can explosively weld pieces of metal together, including disk platters. So that's not the question that I'm looking to answer here. What I'm trying to answer is, can we do it in such a way that we can confine the explosion, right, according to the original rules, And also, I wanted to experiment with some new techniques. In particular, I'd been talking for a few years about 3D printing explosive geometries, right? So there's various configurations of explosives that work better for certain things, and I'll explain them. Can we make them with 3D printing? Because 3D printing's great. And I'd like speculated and basically bullshitted about it to people for years, and I was like, it's time for me to step up and actually give it a shot. So here's what I'm talking about, the Monroe effect. Most people know it as a shaped charge. So you'll hear about that in anti-tank rounds and stuff like that. It's there a way that an explosive device achieves an uncommonly large amount of ability to penetrate armor plate. So what a shaped charge is, the shape refers to a cavity in the explosive block. It's usually conical, but it can also be basically a linear groove, like a triangle groove that is extruded out. And what happens if you have a piece of material, which is most often an armor plate, because you're cutting through something often for the military, but for other reasons too. When you explode the high explosive, the shockwave goes out in all directions, but the cavity concentrates the shockwave. And that produces this kind of a jet that shoots out and cuts through whatever is underneath the cavity. And you can also, if you line that cavity with a metal liner, you can produce what's called an explosively formed penetrator, which is a basically liquefied slug of metal that shoots out with the jet at extremely high speed. So here's what a commercial shaped charge device looks like. The metal liner greatly increases the amount that you can penetrate a plate of whatever it is. You got your high temperature metal jet. The metal you want for the liner is something that's very dense, so it has a lot of kinetic energy behind it, and that is ductile, so it reshapes itself easily. So copper is the most common liner material. Military shaped charges often use tantalum, so because they can afford expensive stuff. So here's a couple of examples of commercial shape charges. These were given to me by a local bomb squad in an area that has a lot of oil exploration. So these are downhole perforators for oil wells. So long story short, you drill an oil well and you put a pipe down it, right? But you're not ready to suck the oil out yet. So the pipe is sealed at the far end while you figure everything else out on the surface. And then when you're ready to suck the oil out, you send a bunch of these down the hole and set them off, and they punch a bunch of holes at the bottom of the pipe, which lets the oil in, and then you suck it out. So, and oil places leave these things lying around everywhere, which is why the bomb squad picks them up, and they hate them, because they're really nasty devices. But at the top, you've got little foil coverings in the metal shell that lets a shockwave in to set it off. It's filled with explosive. You can see the metal liner on both of these. It's a copper conical liner. And then this one on the right has a built-in standoff that gets the distance just right for the jet to form. So here's two perforators that we set off at the same time, buried in the ground with the jet. You know, the cavity is pointing up because otherwise they go flying off and you can't verify that they exploded. The bomb squad doesn't like it when they give you something to dispose of, and instead you fire it off into space and you don't know where it goes. So you may have seen a quick glimpse of those jets forming there. Here's a still frame from that regular speed video, which is just an amazing frame to get. The odds of this, I think, are very unlikely. So you see the two jets forming as they're supposed to do. Over here on the left of screen, you see the residue of the explosion from the blasting cap that's firing it, and we're coupling the shockwave to the penetrators by means of this shock tube. So a shock tube is like a plastic straw that's lined with a thin layer of a high explosive, and it just propagates a shockwave. But it does also break apart after it does that. So this miraculous shot has the jets forming before this tube has had a chance to rupture from the shockwave. So that gives you an example of just how high velocity those perforated jets are. So, all right, let's do this. This is experimental, right? So we're just going to see what happens with a commercial device. So here we've got a penetrator strapped to the side of a hard disk, and here's a slightly high-speed shot of that going off, and you can see half the drive flying off there, but it actually doesn't go a long way. Most of that force is downwards. So that's that piece that you saw flying off to the upper left, really very nicely sheared in half, and there are the platters. So it's just like no problem at all going through these drive platters, right? There's all of the pieces that we recovered from that drive. Half of the bottom case went missing, but at any rate, the most interesting thing in that photo is what is that? This is the plate that we set off the explosion on. So there's a closer look. Oh, it's a hole in that steel plate from underneath the hard disk. There's the exit side of that hole, and there is the ground underneath that. And that piece of wire up the top was what we used to measure how deep that hole went, and that's how deep it went. So definitely presents a blast confinement challenge, right, if you were going to use those particular oil well perforators. But let's get into the interesting research here. So when you're designing a shape charge, you have a few parameters that you can tweak, right? So you've got the apex angle of your cone, you've got the amount of standoff distance for jet formation, and you've got the overall height of the charge, which includes how high above the cone the charge goes. Here is some experiments from the 60s of EFP design that show that's a pretty linear inverse relationship between the cone angle and the jet velocity. So the narrower the cone, the higher velocity the jet you get. So we're not going to want to have a super steep angle to our cone here if we want to be able to confine the blast. So once again, I want to do digital fabrication of these high explosives. So this is great because this allows me to use a CAD package like OpenSCAD to design parametric models. So basically writing functions that define these shape charge shapes, and then the parameters for those functions are things like apex angle, standoff, and charge height, and so on. But to 3D print explosives directly, like any new material of 3D printing, you've got to solve a lot of materials handling problems, right? You've got to deal with how are you going to extrude that material in a decent way, how are you going to support areas that need support, how are you going to deal with homogeneity of the material, isotropic behavior of the finished material, internal voids and stuff like that. We know we care a lot about internal voids with this explosives work. So I decided not to tackle all of those hard problems. Instead, I did a shortcut. And what I wanted to do was print a very thin wall plastic enclosure and then fill that with a self-compacting explosive. So basically a liquid explosive that I knew would have no internal voids and would have exactly the shape of the container it was poured into. So this, as far as I'm aware, is the first example of high explosive 3D printing in the open source literature. You know, we have no idea what's classified, but I think that's pretty cool. So here's the explosive that I decided to use. I'm calling it Felix, Felix Expedient Liquid Explosive. It's similar in concept to these kinds of explosives you can actually get kind of off the shelf in the United States, which is sort of a really interesting, you know, there's a lot of interesting things about the United States. And one of them is that it's like basically, you know, you're right as an American to have targets that explode when you shoot at them. So you can buy this stuff called Tannerite, which is a two-part, you know, it's a binary solid explosive, and you mix it, and then you put it out in the range, and you shoot guns at it, and it explodes. And it's only legal to use as an explosive when you shoot at it with a gun. It's just an interesting thing. So that this stuff is similar to that. It's actually so the Tannerite, you know, this stuff is ammonium nitrate, which you know is a explosive by itself, but it's very insensitive, and it's sensitized with an aluminum powder. So the stuff I wanted to use exists as a commercial product. It sounds very similar to Felix. And I went back to the original patents for that commercial product, and I reverse engineered it. And so it's based on nitromethane, which is, you may know it as high power racing fuel, model aircraft fuel. And then the important part is the sensitizer. It's a very specific particle size aluminum powder that's been coated with a specific quantity of stearic acid. And that turns out to be really important. But the good part about this is that It's not exclusive till it's mixed. You can ship each individual part separately with just Hazmat shipping. And that means for our data center solution, we could have this stuff unmixed. We could make an injector that mixes it. We don't have to have high explosive sitting around our data center because it's not high explosive until that mixing happens. Here's the stoichiometry, actually, an interesting fact, this is reported wrong in the patent, probably deliberately to make it hard, but I can do chemistry and math, so it's like not too hard to figure it out. What you see here is that the nitromethane isn't explosive by itself, so it just decomposes. It doesn't need the aluminum at all to do decomposition, but the aluminum sensitizes it, and the aluminum combines with water that's produced from the nitromethane decomposition to produce additional energy. Reaction products that hydrogen burns, but also it's producing, it adds energy to the whole mix. So it's a quite effective explosive. So here's my first shape charge. I decided to do a linear shape charge that's curled around into a ring because that fits a hard disk platter, and hopefully we can sort of cut through all those platters. And this whole thing fits into 1U. So there's mixing up the Felix, about 60 grams fits into this this piece here, and that has a little standoff around the plastic cup has been cut to be a standoff for the jet formation. So here we go, setting it off. High speed shot of that. And this is another shot of the same geometry, same amount. So you can just see a piece of drive shoot out to the right-hand side of the screen there. But what we learned from this initial stuff, there's the recovered platters. We can see a few interesting things here. Number one, there's a lot of aluminum powder that's coated that drive. So this is the stoichiometric mix of that high explosive. It's too fuel rich. There's no need for this much aluminum. It's not even consumed. It's just wasted spraying all over the drive. So that's an interesting result. Number two, we've stripped all the platters down off the spindle we flattened them together there. So we've done a pretty good job of crushing these platters. We have cut the platters a little bit, but not a lot. The shape charge aspect of this hasn't worked perfectly. It's only worked in one place. And that place corresponds to where the blasting cap was located. So what we can see here is our shape charge has done the right thing where it got initiated, but it hasn't propagated around the ring. So I moved to a radial geometry. We have a bunch of little shape charge slots going off the center. I've made a lid for it too, so that I can feed a deck cord in through that, and so we can initiate it all around the outside. Yeah.
How did you do the 3D printing? What material is that?
It's just PLA. It's like a hobby level 3D printer. Here's the radial shape charge. It holds more explosive. That's great. 100 grams. We're going to use some deck cord to set it off. Let's see how this does. So, you know, we always have to go searching after this for the pieces. We can definitely see that our confinement challenge is going to really make our work cut out for us on this one. We shot this one a long shot with a GoPro here as well in high speed. So pieces go a long way. There's a big fireball. So we know we're going to have some work later on confinement. This is bits that we could find. Every single component has been stripped off the circuit board. The platters are not in great shape. Not only have we cut some holes in them, but we've explosively welded all those platters together. So, all right, you're definitely going to have a hard time recovering anything from this drive. But the important thing here is, can we do blast suppression? So what we want to do is we need that all that force of that blast to be coupled physically to the hard disk. But we want the outside equipment to have the blast decoupled from it. So the explosive is against the drive, and we need some kind of damping material in between the explosive and the equipment shell. And the damping material should, you know, because we need to decouple that force, we need to have an alternation of something that compresses and absorbs the blast, and then something that is incompressible and lets it move through. So basically, we want some kind of a foam. And ideally, we're not the military, we don't want to pay a lot of money, so we want it to be expensive, and we want to be able to inject it into our rack when we need it, because you don't want to be like pulling, when you change drives in the data center, when they fail, you don't want to have to pull them out of this goo and clean them off and so on. You just don't want that foam in there until it's time to destroy stuff. So an explosives engineering instructor said, oh, I know exactly what this stuff is. We use this when we punch locks out. They make these little explosive charges, and they punch locks out of doors, and we put a giant big gulp cup full of shaving cream over it, and it works really well. So I'm like, okay, this seems like one of those pranks, you know, that they pull on you when they, you know, the Navy guys tell you to go get like a bucket of prop wash or something like that. But they're like, yeah, put shaving cream on it, it'll work. But I was like, all right, I'll give it a shot. So this time I'm not doing the 3D printed stuff because I only care about blast suppression. So this is a giant wad of det cord, 41 inches of 100 grain det cord, plus shaving cream in a box. And let's see how we go. So, you know, stuff definitely moves around here, but compare that shot, right, which again is a much bigger shot than we did before. This is the first, the biggest explosion frame from both of the cameras that we had set up. So this is the long shot camera. This is the shot that I just did. The one earlier is this. And both of these are det cord shots. The left one is 2.5 times the explosive weight of the one on the right. So a much bigger shot is very effectively suppressed by that foam. Like, wow, I'm very surprised to me that it worked that well. But you know, we still need to figure out how this is gonna perform in our theoretical 3U rack. So here's another 3D printed shape charge, 75 grams of Felix. I've made a kind of a quick and dirty 1U rack simulator with a steel plate and a couple of angle irons to get the height right. There's our wired up device covered with shaving cream, metal plate on top and a sandbag. Obviously, ultimately it'd be 1U full of concrete or something like that. And here's how it goes. So, you know, that's really impressive to me in terms of how little it threw everything around the place. Here's a close-in shot. I mean, that steel plate doesn't really go up any higher than the hard disk with copper thermite in it. The plate itself, remember, we punched a hole through this with the perforator. It's only got a little dent in it. And the plate at the bottom, we did fold out the angle iron, right? So those were not strong enough on the sides. But we've just imprinted the hard disk on the plate, but essentially no damage, right? We've just scratched it. So once again, from science to engineering, with engineering effort, I think you just might be able to get this to work. So very quickly on the electric one, because I know I'm just running out of time here. The goal with any electric attack is we have electricity in our device, right? So we want to be able to use our existing power source against the media. And in particular, here's where I'm interested in solid state drives. So I didn't work on mass degaussing. We know degaussing works. I didn't work on like exotic EMP, microwave RF attacks and stuff like that. This is just mostly attacking chips with electrical power. So first of all, I thought about using an exploding bridge wire system. So this is a system that's used to initiate detonators in nuclear weapons, for example, slapper detonators and stuff like that. You basically pass enough current as an impulse through a wire that it turns into a plasma instantaneously and explodes. And it produces a high detonation velocity. And instead of expensive SSDs, I'm going to use free flash drives that I got from conferences, because SSDs are still really expensive if you just want to destroy them. So here's just a wire showing you the exploding bridge
Three,
wire effect.
2, 1.
That's real time here in high speed. You don't gain much from 1,000 frames per second there. It basically just vaporizes. So I thought, well, let's physically couple this force to the chip and see what happens. So I've wrapped a few loops of the wire around the flash drive here.
3, 2, 1.
And here's the high speed shot. So, you know, the wire exploded, but it doesn't look like we suffered much damage to the chip. And sure enough, the flash memory chip is essentially unscathed. We did decap the microcontroller on the other side of the board, but it's not a reliable method to break things, at least things that are as strong as electronics chips are. So number two, I did this. This is a high voltage power spike to the ground pin of the chip. So I did this work before the USB killer device was released last year, I think. So this predates that, but you may have seen that device where it's basically a bank of capacitors in a thumb drive form factor, and you plug it into a USB thing and it charges up and then discharges and breaks your computer. I'm doing the same thing here. I'm raising, you know, there's often protection on the power line for of electronics because they expect power to be unreliable, but they usually don't expect ground to be suddenly at 10,000 volts. So I'm going to raise the ground level to 10K with the exploding
Three,
wire rig.
2, 4.
Here in high speed. And that looks a little better. We saw some things separate there. And here we can see that it blew the traces off the board itself. We broke the chip in half and decapped it. So I think that this is definitely a potentially feasible method for destroying banks of flash memory. We don't really know how hard it is, or I don't really know how hard it is to read a part of a damaged flash chip without being able to power it up. Whether an electron microscope or something can do something with it. I've talked to people about it, and they think it's not possible. But anyway, I feel like this could be a way that you could destroy a lot of data very quickly. And then the other one, mostly this is just an excuse for me to show you guys something that many people haven't seen. But in the case of a spinning aluminum shelled hard disk, could we like crush it in an instant with electricity? And the high voltage guys like to do this. They build these things called coin shrinkers and can crushers. You basically dump a huge electric pulse through a coil of wire. The coil induces a reverse magnetic field in what's inside the coil, and so the coil experiences a large force outwards, and whatever's in the middle experiences a large repulsive force inwards. So this is a high-speed shot, 2,000 frames per second, of doing this to a soda can. So that just looks like if you didn't see it sort of sail out, that looks like a real-time shot. I mean, that's incredibly fast. Here's another 2,000 frames per second shot of it. So it's actually just cut the can in half. Once again, there's no physical contact between the coil. The coil is going outwards, and the can is going inwards. So here we are at 100,000 frames per second. So the one on the left, it's basically instantaneous, right, for all intents and purposes. On the right-hand side, the one that, it gets a little blown out there, unfortunately, by the electric arc, but everything happens very quickly. Like, the whole time that I've been talking about this slide, less than 10 milliseconds have elapsed in real time. So it would be great to try this on a real hard disk. I just don't know. I don't know what the power levels are. This rig, I'm sure, doesn't have enough power in it to crush a drive. But I'm sure you could build one. So here's the summary of my experimentation of what's most feasible. So if you're looking, and I do remember, back in the day when like I knew guys that were big wares dudes, right? And they had these giant magnets in their computer rooms, so they would throw into their like floppy disk boxes if they got raided by the feds. So if anyone wants to actually implement something like this for their sensitive data, then I recommend InThermal, the plasma cutter. It worked great. and then the oxygen injection for the more fancy method. But you may require some kind of complex injection system to get that, you know, to go from a virgin hard disk to one that's got oxygen pumping through it. In the kinetic sphere, the nail guns are great unless you're going up against the US government, in which case they're not enough. The damned high explosive, I think, is very feasible. You just have to remember that the blast goes sideways as well as up and down. And the electric sphere, the high voltage power spike, seem to work great, but we don't know enough yet about forensic resistance of SSDs. I wanted to close with a little thought experiment. You know, I mentioned at the beginning, drones going out there and getting captured. So here's a real example from a drone that crashed, a US drone that crashed in Iran, and the Iranians claimed that they hacked it. It doesn't seem likely, but in any case, they did get the drone. So they did get whatever data was on the drone in whatever form it was on. So I wanted to leave this thought experiment about mobile solutions, and it turns out to be really topical right now because of the laptop ban out of airports in the Middle East. So consider this. Didn't notice my Bluetooth watch. For reference, from all the stuff I showed you before, there was about this much deck cord in that laptop. Thank you.
Personally, I have so many substantial questions I can't even start, so go ahead.
We were thinking on the same problems with a couple of friends, and we thought that the best or fastest way without explosives was using acid.
Yeah. So, some other people I know did a bunch of acid attacks on hard disks, and they completely failed. Basically, the hard disks, the platters are super unreactive. That ruthenium coating is just doesn't react to much. I tried a few things too. I just took a bunch of platters out of drives and I put some strong, various corrosive chemicals on them, and they got absolutely nowhere. So I feel like you couldn't guarantee it within the rules, right? Within 60 seconds, they're just too chemically unreactive. Like a big bath of hot acid would eventually dissolve them, especially if you scratch the platters and reveal the raw aluminum, then it reacts easily, but it's just it's not feasible within the rules that I set for this. Okay, it was so ineffective, I had nothing to show, so I just completely got rid of that section.
Do you think with the wire, if you put the hardest or whatever in resin after you put the wire in, that would contain the explosion? Because usually you can get a much better explosion if you pack it really tight, so the pressure couldn't go outwards, but has to turn inwards.
That's probably likely. The only thing is with one chip, you know, it kind of worked okay. And I'm sure if you resin coated that, like, you'd really just totally smash everything in there. When you strengthen a lot of an area, it has to give way somewhere, but you don't know where. So by strengthening the whole thing, you might actually save some of the chips and cause just one of them to fail more dramatically. So that's the only thing I'd worry about with that approach.
Sure. What about high power lasers?
They're great. I'm all in favor. You can certainly get a, you know, go put something under a laser cutter and you'll be able to burn through it. I actually have experimented burning through circuit boards with a laser cutter in order to, like, basically to see if I could save money getting circuit boards made by cutting them out myself on the laser cutter. So you can do a lot of damage to electronic stuff with a laser. And that's got the advantage that you could have just one laser somewhere and a bunch of optics and just, like, fire the beam through a bunch of optics and stuff like that. So it seems like you could probably do that, although it might get expensive.
Anybody else? I was just thinking of maybe that big shredder you had in the beginning, and you have kind of like your hard disk array mounted over one of them, and you press
just drop it.
All of these arrays drop out and into the shredder. Yeah, maybe that could work as well.
Yeah, you know, sometimes the low tech methods really are the best.
Not as fun though. Right?
I have a comment about the thermite melting stuff. It's possible to do it in a feasible way. There is a blog post of Frank of the CCC, which he did it. I can show it afterwards with some nice pictures.
Yeah.
And maybe he's also talking how he did it, and it's really melting out and you can't do anything.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely can melt a drive with thermite. It just turns out you need a lot more of it than you might expect. So if you look at when people do it, the ones that I've seen online, a lot of people, they take all the platters out first and they only melt the platters so they don't have the problem with the heat sink of the case. And then also they'll get like a big flower pot full of thermite, you know, like about this tall, and set it off in there. And so you get just the molten metal dripping down the center. And so you can definitely do it, but making that work in 1U is the challenge.
All right. Thank you again.